There is a huge role for financial institutions in financing literally those new business models, and there's a lot of work there to be done as well.
Oh yeah, what you're telling is completely right. Let's say during a long time it was about the growth of GDP, it was about the financial results per quarter, every quarter of the year, and now it should be much more the long term focus and the social and ecological fundamentals. That's really you're right.
Will it be addressed in WCEF in April?
We are working on this. Absolutely, yes. I think finance is one element of the entire system that we can absolutely not do without. Yep. And so it's also fantastic to see how many financial institutions are seeing how important it is to be really future-proof. Yep. If you want to be future-proof, you need to be climate-proof, you need to be circular economy-proof. And so there's really a lot of movement. Yep. But there's also a lot of knowledge development, experience still to be developed in the financial sector. Mm-hmm. It's great to see they're really moving.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And we need to speed up everything.
And we need to speed
up
everything.
We are not on track at the moment.
That's right. So we need to speed up, but we also need some money. Do you have a figure in your head?
I'm waiting for the cabinet formation, but I mentioned the issue of the budget.
Yeah.
What is the budget regarding the circular economy? This is really key. And the Netherlands is really a front runner, you can say, in different domains.
Yeah.
In some domains, we are walking behind. When you talk about renewals, for example, in circular economy, we're doing well. But we have too much more for ethical reasons and economic reasons.
Right. Yes, thank you. We go to Ruben Dubelaar. You were host of the webinar Textiles. What is your takeaway from that webinar?
Yeah, thank you. Well, as you've seen in the video, I think we have seen some great examples, some great entrepreneurs inspiring. You know, they talked about what they do. And we went through the value chain because I think this is a great platform because it's all about, you know, we're talking about sharing innovations and sharing knowledge. And this is how we start, you know, by highlighting the best practices that we see along the value chain so we can learn from each other. And of course, then we also see that a lot of the technologies and the knowledge is already out there. So it's not only about the innovation. The difficult part for textiles, it's a worldwide industry, you know, with, of course, a lot of, you know, it's worldwide. If you sort here, maybe, you know, the sorted materials need to go to the other part of the world. So that's very complex. So that's why we need collaboration and platforms like these, you know, to really see how we can implement and inskill. Ms. Brownlee already pointed out the innovations. And I think that's the biggest part. And I think all speakers stressed, it was already highlighted, that, you know, we need the regulations and incentives also by the government to help to scale up, but also to create transparency throughout the value chain. Where do feedstock come from? Where do materials come from? And also, can we maybe put a price on the more polluting technologies? So with that budget, we can finance, you know, the more sustainable ones. And of course, it's about, you know, the education and sharing technologies and knowledge to create awareness amongst the consumers, but also to make sure that we have some overarching guidelines on circular design. And
overarching, does that mean worldwide or?
Yeah, I think, you know, as the industry is worldwide, I think, you know, it's about sharing knowledge. How can we design in a circular way? I think that's useful that's, you know, we put it together. And if we design it in a certain way with certain materials, that we can also make sure that it can be recycled also in the other part of the world. And that's how we should collaborate, of course.
Product passports.
And what do you think the participants in your webinar would like to hear from our guests?
Well, I think something that really stood out was Kriti Tula. She's from India. She had a nice company, Doodlets, and they work on upcycling, you know, textile waste. And she said, well, textiles, and it's something, you know, everyone wears it. So it's also a way to communicate to people and to reach people. I think dynamics in India are very different than here in Europe. So it's also a way to convey our, you know, story about sustainability and to reach people. So my questions would be also, how do you think that personally, do you agree? And also, how could the government use the tool, let's say, of the industry to reach everyone in the world to convey this more sustainable message?
Yeah. Yeah. I also have in my ear the question from Mutt Jeans: stop people, consumers, from buying rubbish.
Yeah.
And it's okay. So let's hear Ms. Brownlee in answer to this question. Can the textile industry also be a force to change consumer behavior and create awareness?
Thank you. That's an excellent question. And I do think that is absolutely possible. Textiles being one of those things that we do touch every day, all throughout the day. So they are inherently personal. And that is the opportunity to communicate with individuals about their footprint and about their actions. I think what is interesting for us as policymakers and as conveners and collaborators, as we try to make this happen, whether it's in textiles or any other sector, is to really tell that story. And sometimes what's really important in telling that story is having those examples, having those people that are out there at the forefront, but also having some metrics and some information that we can provide to them. It's something that I think has helped us in Canada on the plastics front, because we were able to say, if we were to achieve zero plastic waste in Canada by 2030, here are the benefits. And we could actually put numbers beside those benefits. So for Canada, that's $500 million Canadian of annual costs avoided. That's a big deal. That's a lot of costs avoided, especially in the current context. Nobody wants unnecessary costs. That's 42,000 direct and indirect jobs. That's a really big deal, too, especially in the current context. And, you know, that's 1.8 megatons of annual GHG emission savings. So when you can concretify or make something concrete like that and really have those proof points and the evidence around it, then I think that your narrative and that story that you communicate to everyone involved in the value chain is that much stronger. Mm-hmm. And kudos on the new report, because I think it does an excellent job of putting those metrics and those numbers out there, which I think is exactly what we can use as a conversation starter with everyone in the value chain.
Good, thank you. But Mr. Ruben asked another question, and he asked, do you have an example personally concerning textiles and your personal shopping? Is there something you have in mind concerning textile, circular economy and climate?
For Canada specifically or for me specifically? I'm sorry, I don't quite understand.
If you, as a person, personal, do you have, if you go shopping, your textiles, is there something, are you aware of circular and climate?
Absolutely. And I think one of the things that, as a consumer, as I've been following circular economy for the past 3 or 4 years, so I think I would consider myself an early mover, as I've been doing this for 3 or 4 years, is, you know, first, it's the true hierarchy of the R's, right? So do I need something new first when it comes to clothing? Can I reduce the need that I have? Can I avoid this purchase? But then if I do find that I have to make a purchase, can I make it by being an informed consumer about what is truly the best solution? Mm. And I have to say, last summer when the pandemic context first hit, I took up running again, because of course a lot of activities were off the possibilities, so running however I could do in my neighborhood. So I needed to invest in running clothes, which I hadn't had in a decade. And I spent a lot of time researching it, actually, and I ended up going with bio-based fabrics that could then be basically composted at the end of their lifespan. I think the challenge is there were fewer options. I did find the Canadian manufacturer, which was important for me. It did cost a little more, though. So, I mean, part of it is getting this to scale so that the cost barrier and those information barriers for consumers aren't there in future.
Thank you for sharing this personal note with us. It's appreciated. Ms. van Veldhoven, the textiles industry and consumer behavior. What can you say about it?
I think it's these examples of how you buy fully circular are fantastic. I hope I'll be wearing a beautiful circular dress also at the WCEF forum. But that's, of course, making a statement. What also is important, I think, is that we look throughout circular economy is more than recycling. So make conscious choices is also about, do you buy clothes which you can wear only 6 weeks or that you can wear for 6 years in the sense of how fashion sensible are they? So I think there's many choices to be made. I think public procurement is also important when you talk about textiles. We use textiles everywhere. It's not just clothing. Textiles is also carpets. It's also curtains. There's a lot of textiles out there, so Absolutely. We can make conscious choices. And let's say perhaps an interesting example is the chauffeurs here at the department needed new suits. And so there was an option. There was a pilot. They could opt for circular suits. And all of the drivers wanted to use the circular suits. So that was fantastic. It created a lot of awareness. So I think these full choices are important for the story. They're about creating awareness. But what I find also very important is, for example, what we did in the denim deal is every genes gets a 5% circular material,
right.
Every gene.
Yes.
So because consumers don't walk around all day with their list of everything they need to take care of and to pay attention to. It should be the new normal. Yeah. And by starting to put 5%, at least 5% in every gene, I think we are also making big differences.
Good.
We need the stories and we need to scale up.
And that way you also create a market for second-hand materials.
You
so that's good.
Create a market for second material. Yeah.
We go to, thank you, we go to Freek van Eyck, he hosted the plastics webinar. What's your takeaway?
Well, I can be generous. I can share a few key observations, actually. Like Mr. van Veldhoven said, plastic has a unique momentum that we can use. We can identify with it, and we are aware of the environmental impact. And the good thing is, as we've heard and have seen on the videos, there is so much happening from the side of entrepreneurs already. Every corner of the world and every part of the value chain. So I think Canada can be really proud of Ice River Sustainable Solutions. The Netherlands can be proud of Ionica. We've seen leaderships from Friesland Campina. A brand said, we don't know if it will work, but we will redesign our beverage cardboards without plastics, and we'll see if it works. So learning by doing, actually. We've seen new business models, which are not geared at the waste management phase, but actually at us, the consumers, what we can do. And that's about refillable, reusable packaging. And it's a business model about convenience, about fair pricing in America, but also in Chile and now also in Indonesia. Especially for plastics, collaboration is key. Everywhere in the value chain, from the beginning to the value chain to the end. Public and private actors working together. But it's also about big retailers, big brands who can make the difference by closing the loop, by using local materials, or by co-financing an initiative. But then again, the downside actually, it's not enough. Businesses can't do it alone. And it's a sad story because the externalities are not priced in, there's a value chain deficit, so in the end we'll need government. We need some new regulations, and regulations, they go slow. Oh, the devil is in detail, there is some opposition, enforcement is typically very difficult, so it's that's tough. But finally, I want to point out the reality of the emerging countries, because imperfect regulation, yes, no, well, let's say no enforcement. Sometimes in some countries, 50% of all the plastics there is imported. And it's already difficult to handle their own material. A huge informal sector, a huge need for awareness, for skills, and difficult to get access to financing. So we need more initiatives like also Mr. Green Africa from Kenya, where a recycler teamed up with the informal sector, but also applying new technology, and he got a big boost from working together with a retailer. It said, we close the loop here in Kenya with local material. That's actually what we want.
Yeah. And what would your participants want to know from the people here at the table and in Canada?
Well, what is the big elephant in the plastics room?
Tell me.
I'm saying that these emerging economies reflect probably better the global reality than the so-called developed countries, where they only manage to recycle 50% of packaging, for example. So I would like to know from regulators, from the big brands, what can we do to change the reality in emerging economies?
Okay, good question. The emerging economies. What can the brands do there?
You mentioned Kenya a few years ago. I was there. I had a meeting with 300 entrepreneurs. It was fantastic because it was all about sustainability.